Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for coming out this morning, and this is somewhere like, I don't know, 550 probably town hall meetings that we've done, just in reason. Laura. Anyway, the reason to have these is to hear from you folks. It's not for me to stand up here and give speeches and go on and on. As we get through this break in August, we go back on September 9th for a session that's going to be very, very busy before the end of the fiscal year. And there's a lot of stuff obviously going on with the debt ceiling and all that. I do want to recognize our state representative here, Jack Drake. Thank you very much for being with us. I think on the invitation or the notice of the meeting, we talked about the identity theft issue, which is becoming more and more prevalent all the time, as you're all keenly aware. The technologies have changed dramatically since the last legislation as far as trying to find a way to put a stop to it, but it can be very, very devastating, obviously, to any individual to lose their identity, what the cost can be to get back and get your finances in order afterwards. So we're looking for input from everyone as to what you believe that we should be doing at the federal level to address the problem. Certainly anyone today, which will be most everyone affected by the, let's say, the Affordable Care Act, things like that, that you can get a lot of scam phone calls and contacts. Obviously, you don't ever give anybody any information that that you don't contact them, so you know who you're talking to first. And that is one of the great ways that they are able to get your personal identity, social security number, that would really negatively affect you in the future. Anyway, if you have any input on that, please let us know. Like I said earlier, when we go back in September, we have the end of the fiscal year in September. October 1st is the start of the new year. The Senate has not done any appropriation bills. We've done five in the House. But what we're looking at certainly is another horrible way of financing the government. That's a continuing resolution, which basically means the spending goes on the same level of last year without any changes. And the sequester will still be in effect. When we get, the Treasury just yesterday came out and said that we will reach the debt ceiling in mid-October. Now, what I believe is going to happen, I am certainly not for any kind of government shutdown for any reason. Especially, you've got people in armed services overseas, their families at home, and to shut down the government and not support women in uniform and their families, veterans, all of those type of things, I think it's just would be irresponsible. Some people talking about because of the Affordable Care Act, President's health care bill, that if they don't be funded, that you'll shut the government down. And to me, that's not being responsible because it will have huge negative impact on, like I said before, our people, men, women, uniform, veterans, and the entire government. It was very, very expensive to do things. I was there in 95 when we had a partial government shutdown, but we at that time we had already funded defense, veterans, all of those things. So this would be much more dramatic, much more negative as far as the impact. What we'd like to see, what I would like to see certainly, is if there's any increase in the debt ceiling that would be offset by spending cuts to at least to that amount. And if you look, and I chair a subcommittee on appropriations, transportation, housing, urban development. On my bill, about $10 billion less in discretionary funding than what the Senate is. I don't know how you ever reconcile that at this point. But what we've got to do, we've already cut about $100 billion in the last 3 years on the discretionary portion of the budget, which is about a third of all spending in Washington. The entitlement, mandatory spending, the two-thirds of the budget along with interest on the debt is where the real problem is as far as long-term. When you look at Charlie or William over here, those kids are going to have to pay the bill for what we're doing today. It's just more of a problem as far as I'm concerned. Hopefully we could come to some kind of a big resolution going forward so that we don't end up in all these continuing resolutions in the future, that we have a path towards some fiscal sanity. We're still going to have about a $750 billion deficit this year. While that's down from, you know, $1.5 trillion, it's still way more than what is sustainable. On the mandatory side, you've got baby boomers like myself, about 10,000 people every day signing up for Social Security and Medicare, 70,000 a week. It's simply not sustainable. You've got the long-term, and this is gonna go on for 20 some years. And the system just will not sustain that. So that's why we have to address, I think, the mandatory side of the budget to actually fix the problem long-term. Obviously, there's a lot of other issues dealing with as far as immigration, tax reform, all of those things that we can talk about anything you want to this morning, but I've said enough. I said I was going to stand up here and talk for a long time. So it's your turn. Okay. Yes.
Would you care?
You always drink Coca-Cola.
Yes. Would you care to explain to us, to all of us, if you could, why no member of Congress has challenged the president in his violations of law, clear violations of law? He chooses to implement some sanctions of the Health Care Act, others he doesn't. And it's really neat, we think, that you people in Congress, you take care of yourselves. When you figured out that you were left on the outside, well, they changed that right now. But nobody challenges the president. I don't understand that.
Well, yeah, we do, I think, but what can you do? I mean, that's, the biggest problem we have today, I think, is that we have a total dysfunctional system on the appropriator. Being an appropriator, obviously, I'm very much involved with that. The fact that the Senate has not passed any appropriation bills this year, did not even have a budget for the previous 3 years. We end up with these continuing resolutions. The power of Congress is the power of the purse. And so as we go through, we put funding limitations, prohibitions that they can't do certain things in the administration, whether it be with the Affordable Care Act, with the EPA, with all of the Treasury, things like that, that are the IRS. It never happens because the Senate doesn't do anything. And then you end up in a continuing resolution that just keeps funding government. The arrogance today of the bureaucracy is something I've never seen before. And that's how they can get away with this, because they have taken away what is Congress's power by being dysfunctional.
That doesn't explain why no member of Congress has challenged the president.
Oh, we have.
For violations of the law? Is he exempt? He's not the king, he's the president.
Yeah, I totally understand that. And we have it, but and people, a lot of us have made statements certainly that it is wrong what he's doing. I'm just saying, how do you stop him at this point? And that's why that's the point I was trying to make, that our power is with the purse. And when we can put prohibitions in it, will stop them from doing things that are not. You know, it goes back, if you want to, you know, EPA regulations, there's no authority for a lot of the stuff they're doing, the new regulations. The IRS, obviously, what they were doing is wrong. And we, but yeah, and to ignore, you look at immigration law, all of those things that, you know, it's basically just saying I won't enforce that. And it's, taking away our power, is, you know, that's the frustration we have. It's to their, it's to the bureaucracy's advantage to have Congress, in essence, be dysfunctional, and a lot of people know that, and can, and purposely continue to make it dysfunctional when it doesn't happen. Are we done? No, yeah.
Along the same lines, what Jim just said, and what you just answered, was that we have a dysfunctional system in there. And as I sit back and I always quote the guy I quote that I make a book where all the leaders are. You know, throw the bones out. And as I sit down and I look at the fair tax, you know, and advocate the fair tax, I mean, that's a huge shakeup of the system. The system, as we know it, is going downhill quickly. I come back to, you and I talked sometime back several years ago about the sunset of our, you know, 2 years, 4 years, and you're out. How many congressmen or senators, by the way, I also see the deficiencies in that, where we have Grassley and Harkin in very powerful positions to maintain some of the issues that we need to have fulfilled in Iowa, but also we need to have that 2 years, 6 years, and you're out. Mm-hmm. Two terms, four terms. What's your position, and where do you see the possibilities of any congressman or senators giving up their position after a certain period of time and walking out the door?
Just kind of practical, you know, the Senate will never go for that, because what that would do would be to terminate the House members out, who would then be free to run against senators in their elections. They would have to go along. I voted for Ken Lennon's back in 1985, you know, supported it. I never signed any pledge as far as term limits. I understand. On a practical note, I'll say also is that you will greatly empower staff to run there. Because as big and as complex as the federal government is today, it's very difficult for an individual to get their arms running and know how to operate and to be effective. So you empower staff. I will tell you, the House of Representatives, you will never have somebody who chairs a subcommittee on appropriations from Iowa, because you would have basically with all the large states, you know, a very urban body to begin with, but with all the large states would join together, and it would be all of their people who chair every committee or subcommittee, and the small states would have no problem. So there's some disadvantages. I mean, I understand where you're coming from, but I think this on parking matters probably not ever happen.
Is there anything that the constituents can do, or we can do?
Bells to quit. Yes, I no. No, I mean, if people want anything, need the petition Congress for it, to make sure to see if they will go along with. I would say on a practical matter, it's probably pretty difficult to see it actually happen.
Congressman,
yes.
What is your
position on the Common Core state standards? I've heard a lot about it. To get into real specifics, I don't have to say that I've been involved in the appropriations stuff and all about it, so I haven't studied that closely. Generally speaking, any idea of the federal government having more authority locally is highly opposed. I really believe that the best schools, best education are when you have local control and power. If there was one vote that I would ever take back, there would be no child left behind, because they've got federal involvement much greater in the local school district. Generally speaking, I would not be in favor of all.
It was
adopted
under the Culver administration in 2010. school's principal. And I've read through the minutes of the past school board meetings for the past year. And I did not learn about the Common Core until 2 weeks ago. But after reading the minutes to my school's board meetings, I did not find in the past year any mention of the pros and cons of the Common Core. And so that leads me to believe that either our school had discussed it prior to 1 year ago, or there was no discussion about it. But I did read in last January that they were using my children as experiments in the classroom to implement the Common Core. And unbeknownst to me, and all the other parents in our community, our school is now using the Common Core, which I have a strong opposition to. So,
what kind of questions or information are they getting about you and your children?
This is the first year of implementation of the Common Core, and according to what I've read on, I can't remember if it was the Iowa Department of Education website, but it's not mandatory to implement it until next school year, 2014-2015. But we're seeing in other states, 45 states have adopted the Common Core. We're seeing other states start fighting against it because the what they're teaching in math is subpar. For example, they're not even requiring algebra to be taught by the eighth grade. In the English language arts, the literary classics are no longer required to be the majority of the reading. Instead, they are required to read filth, such as The Blue Skies by Toni Morrison, written in the 1970s, which it is not appropriate for any person to read, let alone school-aged children. So what I am suggesting is that you urge Congress, urge Governor Branstad to withdraw his support for the Common Core. And I also think that people need to know about this, because if it's in Kingham School District, I'm sure it's in Atlantic, in Bristol, and another school district. And the parents, from what I've spoken to numerous parents, they don't even know. They have no idea about this.
Good morning.
Our principal and superintendent don't even have a clear picture of what it is.
And the teachers are afraid to speak
out. How do they implement it if they don't have it?
Right, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
I've heard a lot of concern about
it. They have carrots of federal funding. They get government funding for the school districts. They feel they have to adopt it, or they lose their funding.
And we lose our voice as parents into what our children.
We totally lose any local control with the Common Core standard implementation. We lost, it is against our 10th Amendment. Another violation of the law.
Right.
Like Obamacare.
Exactly.
And the next red flag is the next generation science standards, which will be voted on, from what I've read, in January.
Voted on in Congress? Voted on to adopt as a state.
They will be voted on, from what I've read, in January. So I urge you, Congressman, to let people know about these things.
Okay.
And the information from the Iowa Department of Education, I do not trust, because a website that is or a government institution that has received millions, if not billions, of dollars from the federal government, I do not believe that their position will be completely unbiased and that they will report the truth. So, I looked at the Iowa Department of Education, and I don't believe that they are reporting to be accurate.
I've heard a lot of concern, primarily about the information that they're mining and what they're getting from
data mining.
Right.
Which I studied German in college, and I've been over to Germany. And from what I've learned is that they will start picking occupations for children very young, based on their scores for these standardized tests, as they do in other countries such as Germany. That's a concern of mine.
please keep us informed to as to what you're seeing, and that would be very helpful. Cases that we can use as examples of what's going on would be very helpful. Okay. Very good, thank you. And Jack, do you have about anything to say?
It's a lot of we passed, I think, in 2005, to give the Department of Education the Iowa Department for to develop their program. And I'm not sure of this, but about 2008, well, we give that to the Department of Education.
Right.
And then in 2010, they opted to go with the Common Core from the federal government. And it's something that I almost certainly will be talking about this year in the legislature. And because there's a lot of concern.
But it's been adopted already. It's already being used in schools. It did not go back.
It's not supposed to take effect until next year, next school year.
But there was an effect. And other schools across the country have already been using it for I don't know how many years. And we're seeing that school districts and states that have been using it for more than 1 year, they're beginning to fight against it. I forget what state. But I know there's a superintendent. I just need to find out what state it is. But he's fighting it in his local area. And he's drawing national coverage.
Is that Mr. Pelzer?
No, I wish it was, but it's not. No.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
According to the news this morning, it sounded like we're going to introduce Syria and get involved with him in the Middle East without congressional approval. My son spent 15 months in Iraq back in 2003, 2004 when they withdrew. He told me, Dad, I feel like we lost war. And things are, from what I hear on the news, basically going back to the way it was in Iraq. We do a little bit of something in Syria and go back out. What good is it going to do? Are we going to start getting involved like we did in Libya? And then that turned into kind of a mess. But a lot of this goes back to what he was talking about. He was talking about when you get elected, you choose to take a swear oath to uphold the law of the Constitution. And the most biggest problem we got right now is nobody's paying attention to what the Constitution actually says as to what people can and can't do. And you guys should have the ability to challenge the president and say, hey, you're violating the Constitution right now.
Well, and the speaker has made it very, very clear that they should not do anything without authorization from Congress in Syria. And that certainly is my, I don't really believe that we have, I mean, there's no way, Syria has not declared war on us. It is an independent country. I hate what's going on there. It's horrible. Why we would start escalating the crisis unilaterally from us, I think would be against that. So,
you have to, but we'll say you're going to be, do some good and be able to end it, not just let it continue on for a while, and just like as we've done in other countries after 5, 6, 7, 8 years. Just,
what you're saying, you know, in Iraq, the biggest problem, you know, the mistake that was made was to for our troops to leave there entirely. And because now you've got the sectarian wars going on in Iraq, and it's being influenced by Iran. The Syrian conflict is basically the same.
What's going right back into the
Shiite Sunni battle that goes on. And I'm certainly not in favor of any additional involvement in this stuff. And the president should, I believe, ask to come to Congress before he does. I know the speaker put out a statement this over the weekend specifically saying that the president needs to come to Congress.
Well, he may not. That's the problem. He may not.
that would, that's also my concern. What are the numbers? Oh, NATO versus us, attack, umbrella of NATO, it's basically, it's, there would be NATO without us. I don't know how you affect anything with like cruise missiles or something like that.
Actually, they matter.
Certainly, our position, President's foreign policy, that we have deteriorated any opportunity for us to be basically a peacemaker or have influence in that whole region.
I'll agree with you.
It's crazy.
Yeah. At least I've learned by now, either fight, win, or don't get in. Is that what you are? As I'm trying to build a wall around that area over there and let them kill each other, right? None of this. We don't need to get involved.
Well, the rules of engagement are in Afghanistan. I mean, if you have, you know, you get somebody on the battlefield, you have to read it. You can only respond as you can. I mean, if you're going to do that, there's no reason to have it. No, you're exactly right. Rules of engagement are ridiculous in the war. From what I can force them to do.
I usually have to worry about what I said. If anyone I'm told, I don't care.
Yes, sir. I think we need to do more toward better the independence so we're not relying on the Middle East. I can't say anything wrong with when we have a peaceful pipeline.
Right.
But people say we're going to be like, well, maybe they're not. I would find lying there in the pipeline going across my water.
Right.
I've got the gas line
across the water. A lot of lines do already.
And I have no problem with it. There's a problem. It's crazy. These companies are very, very conscious of safety violations.
We have
opportunities.
We have such a great opportunity. 5 years we've been doing the investments. Keystone Pipeline is one part of it. It's not in the State Department. It's a very extensive study. There's no environmental impact. We're going to be getting that oil. Highly ground, no matter whether it's pipe here or whether it's shipped to China. It's still going to be. As far as environmental impact, it has no impact. But it has a huge impact as far as, I won't say North American independence. And what that would do in places like the Middle East, as far as our involvement, basically you could say, too bad we don't need your oil. North Dakota, Pennsylvania, Texas, we have just unbelievable opportunities.
And a lot of promotion for the last year.
Okay. But, Keystone should be approved immediately as far as I'm concerned. That's just nonsense to drag this thing out there. What I also would like to say, this gets back to the transportation, involved a lot of the transportation. This year, our obligation to the federal government and the highway bill is to pay the states about $41 billion a year for them to use in the construction projects in the state. On the point, our revenues are about $27 billion for gas tax. And this, the highway trust fund is going to be paid by next August. It's going to be totally which we may have to find either with the reauthorization of a new highway bill, a new building, or some source of funding. Lunch is here, all right. Some source of funding. But I think we should do, have a steady stream of revenue and have it earmarked specifically for infrastructure. We can hope that we have
try to stop it up in North Dakota.
Well, there's still some red rules of the basic EPA.
Yes, sir.
I want to ask Dr. Carlos, and it seems pretty simple, and there may not be a problem.
Well, we had the first attempt, as you well know, failed on the floor lines. Okay, then we took and separated out of the farm section from the nutrition. Talking about $100 million annually expanding, about 80 million dollars for nutrition program. So we basically took the farm portion past that. In September, the expectation is that we'll have a nutrition title on the floor lines. Probably was larger. Reforms of the nutrition program to try and get that passed so that we can actually get the conference of that. We are committed as part of that. We should have done a long time ago. It looks like I think there was a strong opportunity for October to get it done. Hope springs eternal. You have to be an optimist in this job. But no, that's the plan. Technically, right now, we could conference the December with just the farm provisions, because an item that's in either the Senate or House versions is conferenceable, and you get together to work out differences. But technically, we could do a conference without passing the new nutrition title and bring it back to the House. So, Matt, you know, obviously, again, a question of getting the votes to pass it. We've got folks who don't think it cut. You know, the original farm bill from the floor of the House was about $20 billion over 10 years of reduction support. The farm portion is 20%, and about $20 billion cuts in nutrition reform of nutrition that would give about 20% savings over 10 years. And that's 80% of the spending. Some folks that wasn't enough of a reduction, some folks it was too much, and that's fine. Okay. But we've got to find the sweet spot someplace to pass this.
NSA.
Well, it is. There were two bills on the floor. One basically saying that to prohibit them from using any individual information, any content for an American. Which I voted for. Another one basically was, I felt, a lot of people felt it was unconstitutional, and that basically they were telling the court how they had a vice of court which controls what they can and cannot do, telling them the burden that they had to come to. There's a separation of powers. Congress can't tell courts what their ruling should be. But the revelations of the last couple of weeks of what has come up is going to be a major issue when we get back. That it just keeps getting worse and worse and worse all the time with what they're doing. And if they were, and this almost seems like there's total incompetence, and that they're losing information or getting information that shouldn't. Not knowing what they're doing is very, very concerning. We've got it. There will be an intelligence reauthorization bill this fall that I think is really going to clamp down on NSA or other reforms to make sure that, that it was not, it was known with the intelligence committee, the leadership, the programs that they were doing, the general, was on a need-to-know basis, basically, when Congress, we were never agreeing for all these programs. It's the intel reauthorization is going to clamp down.
Thank you, Lee, for it, first of all.
Yep.
Yes, sir. Well, listen, there was something else that hurt us, and we're cool, Powell was saying, we feel Republican Party should not pursue border identification because of the alien idea that that's passed back at the border. I feel like everything I do, we have to have to do. Legal dispatch system, I don't understand why they would object to having just a citizen vote. You have two people in council bus. They arrested them or what, but they did find a few illegal aliens and actually voted in council bus in the election. They should be cut and dried. You need to get pre-registered, or you have an ID, or